wondering where Stuart is. He is working with Diane on the Christian, on the Christmas pageant, and he will join us at the time of the beach somewhere around there. They all come back here. I just say that if you're wondering where Stuart is. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Tony and I made friends with our dining mates on our fall cruise this past October to New England and Quebec City. Our new friends, Larry and Marilyn, are a Jewish couple from New Jersey. The first evening we sat next to them, we talked only to each other's partner. What a strange, walled-off feeling that was. Tony and I decided that this would have to change, as we were going to be dining partners for 2 weeks. We decided to say something silly the next evening that would startle and spark a conversation between the four of us. By Portland, this is our second stop, Maine, Tony and I were seeking out Jewish synagogues for Larry and Marilyn and telling them what we learned about the Jewish population in the town. Larry and Marilyn were only doing walking tours of the various places that we docked, while Tony and I had prepaid for trips. Our new friends were both retired and widowed, and they were partners, travel partners, with a very limited expense account. In Sydney, Nova Scotia, we took a tour on how the immigrant population shaped the town and its needs. They needed miners and smelters and railroad builders and seafarers to create itself. Several years before, the Jewish population in Sydney gave their old synagogue to the Sydney Immigration Museum when they had built a new one. This museum was filled with artifacts from various Orthodox populations from Europe, Muslims from the Middle East, Protestants from Germany and Sweden and Norway, Roman Catholics and Jewish communities. In the bottom of this museum was the old mikvah, built permanently into the basement of the old Jewish synagogue. Aha, I said to myself, this is my chance to see a mikvah. Spelled M-I-K-V-A-H or V-E-H. So what's a mikvah? Anybody know?
It's a sacred washing
place. It's a bath. It's a pool. It's a tub, big tub. A large tub that holds water for purification. If you convert to Judaism, you must be bathed in a mikvah. You must go under the water completely, every hair. Brides and grooms are purified in a mikvah. Thus, you have a total of 150 gallons of water found in those jugs at the wedding of Cana. It isn't exactly a sprinkle, okay? It is a bath. Now, John the Baptist is using the Jordan River as a mikvah. You can use rainwater or running water. There's all sorts of rules in Leviticus about what goes in the water. But John the Baptist is using the Jordan River as his mikvah to purify repenting and confessing sinners. Baptist is dressed like Elijah, in animal skins and eating weird things, and crying out, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." So who is this to come? People look east. The time is near. Make your house fair. Trim the hearth and set the table. People look east. sing today. Love the guest. It's on the way. Mark's gospel begins with a brief fanfare. In the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, Son of God. And then he launches into another messenger, John, who bursts on the scene with the good news. Mark is the first one to use the term good news, which means what?
Gospel.
This good news is for all nations under heaven, all. And Mark ends this gospel with this same news. This made me think of that wonderful canticle, I guess we call it. It's kind of like a psalm or a canticle that Simeon says when Jesus is brought to the temple 8 days after birth for his dedication. And some of you may remember this. Lord, you now have set your servant free to go in peace as thou hast promised. For mine eyes have seen the Savior, whom thou hast prepared for all the world to see, a light to enlighten the nations and the glory of your people Israel. God is doing a new thing, but not without the past. Where does it all begin? Quoting from Isaiah, John is identified with Elijah, the one who prepares the way for the Messiah. God lets us know that he points to Jesus. All this sounds very familiar, the beginning of Mark's gospel. It reminded me of the beginning of John's gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. He was in the beginning with God. Joyous, urgent, anticipation, preparation, Advent. Prepare for the coming of the Promised One. Preparation involves repentance and confession. Facing the truth about ourselves and changing direction. Now, who really wants to do this? Good news? Sounds more like bad news. What must I repent and confess to be ready? Is it the lines that I draw between others and myself? Roman Catholic? Episcopalian? Lutheran? Jewish? Baptist? AME? Muslim? Evangelical? My lines, not God's. Oh God, forgive me, for I am not seeing your beloved people as ones whom you love. I need to go in the Jordan and be washed in its waters. I need the deep water so that every strand of my hair is made wet. Why was John the Baptist popular? Curious came. He did look weird. Nostalgic came, imagining the good old days. But some came for repentance and confession, to turn their hearts towards God. They sensed God was about to do something new. Protect the Arabids, that they alone are favored. Repent that they alone are exempt from all demands put on others. Repent for thinking they are better than their worst neighbor. They came to abandon clever devices for maintaining the illusion of innocence. What could be better news? To be cleansed, to be forgiven, to make room to be loved by God, so God's love can be shared with all the others that we meet. Love makes faith, not the other way around. John gave his listeners hope, and he gave it to them in a way that they could enter that hope. Yet John stays focused on the future, on the one to come. He holds looking back and holds looking forward with tension. This is a yearning for God to reside in our hearts, our yearning for fulfillment. Our story in Advent begins with yearning. John is waiting for the adult Jesus. If you thought caring for a baby was demanding, the adult Jesus is more. Love. Loving is tough. John is also pointing to the continuing presence of the Holy Spirit. Yes, the Holy Spirit is the gift to anticipate in Advent. Nativity, Holy Comforter. We got it covered, guys. We are so positioned to point to love. The guest is on its way. Jesus pointed beyond himself to the one that is coming, the Holy Spirit, the continuing presence of God as love in this world. And this love, too, is held in the tension between the past, the present, and the future. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And in the tension, we find God's love. This passage begins by gathering up ancient echoes of Israel's history and our history, and concludes by reaching into the present moment and beyond. Rabbi Mirbai Star puts it this way. He's still alive today. I've been drawn to the living heart of every spiritual tradition I have encountered. What I found irresistible was the essential unity at the core of all that diversity. Each faith tradition was singing the same song in a deliciously different voice. God is love. Love, the guest, is on the way. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.